So big tech is at war with the First Amendment, and the terrible, terrible thing is that they don't even know they're at war with the First Amendment. It is the biggest threat to the First Amendment I can ever remember. It is just, it's absurd. And the thing about it is, you know, they took Donald Trump, the president of the United States, they took him off all his social media, YouTube and Twitter, Facebook, Snapchat, Reddit, TikTok, and they even are trying to stop him from having any kind of campaign money raising abilities, everything. They are just trying to shut him down. These are billionaire leaders of corporations shutting down the president of the United States, and it's just the beginning. Here, Project Veritas got this terrific video of Jack Boots Dorsey, who runs Twitter, telling, this is him talking to his staff, and one of the staff recorded him and gave it to Project Veritas, saying, this is just the beginning. When he says we're focused on one account, he's talking about Donald Trump. Listen to what he has to say.
We are focused on one account right now, but this is going to be much bigger than just one account, and it's going to go on for much longer than just this day, this week, the next few weeks. It's going to go on beyond the inauguration. We have to expect that. We have to be ready for that. So the focus is certainly on this account and how it ties to real world violence, but also we need to think much longer term around how these dynamics play out over time. I don't believe this is going away anytime soon, and the moves that we're making today around QAnon, for instance, is one such example of a much broader approach that we should be looking at and going deeper on.
So, I mean, this has been coming for a long time. And I tweeted recently that it is spacious reasoning to say that these are private companies and they can service anyone they want. Our right to free speech comes from God, and the government's job is to protect it. And if a company, a corporation, has become big enough to silence free speech, then the government has the right to stop them by any means necessary, and that's what has to happen. So, you know, what they always say to you is, well, if you don't like it, you can start another, or you can start your own company. So they started Parler to compete with Twitter, and they have now shut down Parler, and they've done it in every possible way. Parler is suing. I think they're suing Amazon, aren't they? They're suing Amazon, but they have just completely denied them service. They've cut them off the internet, essentially. And so they say, yeah, you can compete, and then we'll destroy you, too. So it's all totally phony. You know, 2018, Tim Cook, the head of Apple, made a speech to the Anti-Defamation League. So I wanted to bring this up to show you that this has been on these guys' minds for a long time, and it's been happening. I could not find, this was a big speech, I could not find the speech. It took me half an hour to track down the one clip I could get from it. It wasn't even the clip I wanted. But why do you think that happens? Because, well, listen to it and you'll see why it happened.
We only have one message for those who seek to push hate, division, and violence. You have no place on our platform. You have no home here. From the earliest days of iTunes to Apple Music today, we have always prohibited music with a message of white supremacy. Why? Because it's the right thing to do. And as we showed this year, we won't give a platform to violent conspiracy theorists on the App Store. Why? Because it's the right thing to do. My friends, if we can't be clear on moral questions like these, then we've got big problems.
So why did they take it down? Because it's the wrong thing to do, because he's this billionaire head of a corporation saying, oh, I decide what hate is. You know, you're hateful. It's like Oprah Winfrey with her cars. You're hateful, and you're hateful. And yes, if you think a man can't become a woman, that's hateful. And if you think, if you're a Catholic and you think that homosexuality is a sin, you're hateful. I decide because I am a billionaire owner of a corporation, head of a corporation. And when you're a billionaire, then you can decide what's hateful. That's the way the First Amendment dies. This guy sitting like, you know, some kind of French king sitting around just declaring which of us is hateful. And we know the left. We know they think everything is hateful. And we know they play gotcha games with us. Oh, you said this once. They don't judge. It's not like they judge a person by his entire philosophy. Today is Ben Shapiro's birthday. Happy birthday, Ben. They're attacking him and they throw up something he said. First of all, a lot of stuff he said when he was like 19 years old. But they throw up something he said here, something he said there. And they say, oh, well, that's racist and this is racist. But, you know, I know Ben pretty well. He's not a racist. He's just not. So who is to decide? They set the rules. You know, today one of the I tweeted saying that Ben is not a racist. People started, of course, the left started throwing up these examples of things they thought were racist. And one of them was a video the Daily Wire put up on Columbus Day many years ago. And it was teasing the people who say it was bad that Columbus discovered America because the poor Native Americans, and they were making jokes about Native Americans being primitives while the Europeans brought all this civilization and all this. It was a funny, you know, satirical video. Now, neither Ben nor I had anything to do with that video. Ben was on vacation when it went up. When he came back, when he saw it, he ordered it taken down, and he apologized for it because he thought it was racist. I also had nothing to do with that video and, frankly, wouldn't have made the video for complicated reasons, but I wouldn't have made the video. But I disagreed with Ben strongly then and now. I disagreed with him because I don't think we should let the left set the terms of anything, and I think we should be allowed to make stupid, sophomoric jokes about even race. That's what I think. I think friends make jokes about one another, especially guy friends. You know, guy friends make jokes about one another. If we're all going to live in this big country together, we've got to be able to make jokes about one another without being canceled. And this is a terrible thing the left has done for us. So they seize on that, an incident they know nothing about, and they say, oh, you're a racist, you're hateful. And that can get Ben canceled. That can get people canceled because Tim Cook is in charge. You know, you're hateful. I decide. I'm the corporate king. I decide what's hateful. And then, you know, they lie. Jack Dorsey is a guy. I mean, I would never turn my back on this guy. I tell you, he is just this kind of plausible deadpan. I'm going to tell you what's what. And so he puts out a series of tweets saying, I do not celebrate or feel pride in our having to ban Donald Trump from Twitter or how we got here. After a clear warning, we take this action. We made a decision with the best information based on threats to physical safety, both on and off Twitter. But here's David Marcus writing in the New York Post. Twitter hosts a Kill Trump hashtag. In all of the glorious English language, there's no clearer, plainer, or shorter way to call for violence than the word kill followed by someone's name. But there it is. One of these tweets reads, arrest Trump, not enough to kill Trump. And this isn't new. Back in June, the hashtag assassinate Trump was bouncing around the website with gems like someone take this clown out now. That tweet is still up. They are lying. While Trump's alleged calls for violence, in fact, he explicitly called for peaceful protest, they got him banned. The Ayatollah Khomeini tweeted this in November. Palestine will be free while the fake Zionist regime will perish. There's no doubt about this. This is so encouraging. A completely legal challenge to election results gets our president banned, but the leader of Iran's brutal state threatening to wipe out Israel is no problem at all. And it just goes beyond this. It's so dishonest. It's so wrong. And by the way, it's also dangerous because Donald Trump was elected because people were unheard. When I say they were committing suicide at such rates in the Midwest. A lot of white people doing it, too, committing suicide because they were in despair, because Obama didn't even know they were there. So many dying deaths of despair that the actual life expectancy of Americans, over 300 million Americans, it went down. That's how many people were dying deaths of despair, and they didn't even know it. They were there. So they were angry. They were unheard. They elected Donald Trump to make themselves heard, and now they're going to silence Donald Trump. What the hell do they think the reaction to that is going to be? Where do they think that anger is going to go? They think it's just going to disappear like a puff of smoke? You know, I mean, it's not. That's not what happens. When you look back at where real violence and real tyranny arise, they arise when people, when they try to suppress opinions they don't like, instead of facing those opinions and reasoning with them and talking and educating people against them.